welcome to my next video. I apologize, I wanted to get this out a few days earlier, but I've been sick with a cold and actually ended up working a couple extra hours at work this past week, so I was not able to do this when I had wanted to. For this video, I am going to talk about things I had wished that I had known when I was actively trying to conceive, or TTC as it is known. This is a video about actively trying to conceive a baby, so keep in mind, I'm going to go into details on some things. I'm going to talk about sex and other details of your body, so if you're not comfortable hearing about that, don't watch this video. Louie, my cat, has joined us for this video. He's really comfy and I didn't want to make a move, so he's just going to hang out with us for a little while. So one of the first things that I wish I had known was that it can take an active couple up to a year to actually try to conceive. A young, healthy couple, it can take a full year before you actually conceive a child, and this is not uncommon. It's after you hit the year mark that you start looking into infertility issues or other things that could be causing you to not get pregnant. But honestly, it can just take a long time. This is something my OB did tell me when I went for a checkup. And I talked about wanting to try to for a baby, so it was something I was told at the beginning, but it was something that I was surprised by. I did not know this. So keep in mind, it might take you a while. When you first start trying, you want to get used to seeing those negative pregnancy tests month after month. It can happen. It can be disappointing, even if you know it's coming, so just prepare yourself for that. Losses are out there in the trying to conceive world. A negative test is called a BFN, which is a big fat negative. Positive test is called BFP, or a big fat positive. So again, don't be discouraged if you see a lot of those BFNs time after time. It's normal. Sorry, I have notes over here that I'm trying to keep track of. Another thing to keep in mind, a lot of people use ovulation apps, especially nowadays with your smartphones. It's easy to download one on your smartphone that says, oh, you're ovulating. But these apps are not very accurate. Most, they go on an average cycle length. A cycle length is from your first day of your period to the first day of your next period. So for average cycle length, it's 28 days. And that is, according to that schedule, you ovulate somewhere around day 14, but this is not really the case for every woman. Cycle lengths can vary greatly from woman to woman. Some people can have shorter cycles, some people can have longer cycles. You can go 21 days up to even in the 40s. So it's really not good to go by one of those apps. It's not going to be that much of a help to you. Not have a regular cycle. Also, you're not going to know your cycle and how long it is unless you're keeping track of it after you've been off birth control for a while. If you start on birth control and then you go off it, it might take your body a little while to regulate. You could go right to normal right away, you could get pregnant right away, but a lot of people, it'll take them a few months to adjust coming off of birth control. Myself, I was actually off of hormonal birth control for a year before we started trying to conceive. I was just using condoms. I had ran out of my prescription, and we knew we were going to want to try for children eventually. It was easier to just not get another prescription for me. And I actually kind of liked the break from having to take a pill every day. So that worked out, but it's kind of up to you every day. So just be aware, you could get pregnant coming right off of birth control. And it also might take you a while. So some people like to plan for a couple months in between birth control and actively trying to conceive to give your body time to regulate. Another tip that was given to me through some people on forums that I was on was that something I heard come up a lot was that you're regular until you're not. So basically this means you could have a very regular cycle, say you're always right on the mark 28 days every month. You might have a random cycle where you're not 28 days. This doesn't mean necessarily that you are in fact pregnant if it goes longer. It doesn't mean something's wrong if it goes shorter. It can get frustrating when you're trying to conceive because you are so in tune with everything that's going on with your body. Every little change makes you think, oh, maybe I'm pregnant. But it's not necessarily the case. Some people spot when they ovulate or get cramps. Some people don't. You might experience this randomly throughout your cycle. You might expect to say, oh, I know I'm ovulating because I had spotting. And then next month you don't get any spotting, and then you'll kind of wonder where it's up. This is normal. It just happens. Things vary. And you might just not notice it on a regular basis because you're not paying as close attention to your body. So I found that to be great advice. Another thing is that having sex more is not necessarily better. I've read about people trying 2 or 3 times a day, which to me is very excessive. But honestly, it's not necessarily a better thing to have sex more frequently. It's more about timing than anything else. There's actually some things that say that if you have sex more frequently, it can lower the sperm count of your significant other. So it's not necessarily the best tool to get pregnant. But that's also arguable whether or not that actually happens. They say the best time to get pregnant is if you keep track of your ovulation and you have sex just that week. Not necessarily just that week, but some people will go on, say, every other day or however much they feel like it throughout the month. When it comes to ovulation week, they'll up it to once a day or once every other day. Ovulation day is a big point. You want to try to hit that day every cycle, obviously, but usually you want to also stretch it to 2 to 3 days after, just in case you ovulate a couple days after you think you do. And sperm can survive in your body for up to 5 days. So having sex a couple days before your ovulation doesn't mean you're not going to get pregnant if you hit your ovulation a little later. So if someone's going to be out of town, things are busy, you don't necessarily make it on the day of, you could still get pregnant that month. So for me, I actually was tracking my cycle, track things. We were on our 4th cycle of trying when I did get pregnant, and I was actually really upset because I ended up in the hospital for a night due to an arm injury the day I thought I was going to ovulate. So I thought that totally ruined my chances for that month, and that we weren't going to get pregnant that month, and I was going to have to wait again another month, which wasn't that bad because we were only 4 months in, and that's really not a long time. But I was very frustrated by it, and lo and behold, I ended up getting pregnant that month. So I don't know if we hit ovulation a little bit earlier, or it was actually later than I thought. Now, and this brings me to my next thing, which is charting. Now, charting is a way to keep track of your ovulation. It can be a little intimidating at first. You look at it and you're like, that's way too much work. I don't want to go into it, but it's really not that hard. The best way to chart is by just buying, you have to buy specifically a basal body thermometer. It's going to take your temperature to the 10th point. So a normal thermometer would be like 97.4, this would be 97.41. So you take your temperature first thing in the morning before you get up, before you talk, while you just wake up, you immediately take your temperature. So this can be a little hard for some people. It's also best to do it around the same time every day. For me, this wasn't as hard as I thought it was going to be. I was getting up for work around 5:30, so I just set my alarm for 5:30, checked my temperature before I actually got up, and then I got up and started my day. On my days off, I still set my alarm for 5:30, took my temperature, went right back to sleep afterwards. And you just write your temperature down. Or you can even use an app on your phone and keep track of it, again, if you have a smartphone. And that way, you don't even need to stop to write it down. I know my thermometer would save the last temperature, too, so if I was half asleep and took my temperature, I could just turn it on and see what it said the next time. It can be a little hard with that because it would be very quickly, so if I didn't read it fast enough, it would disappear forever, but I know that did help to be able to go back and check it. And the way this works is you will see a rise in your body temperature when you ovulate. So it needs to be a continuous rise. So it will usually be after 3 days. You'll know that that was actually ovulation. Between up a day and then go back down. So it's hard to say. Now, when I was in that hospital that time, I missed temping that day, so I wasn't really sure that I had ovulated that day, because that would have been my third day of a higher temperature. Or I may have ovulated later in the week when I had another temperature spike. So it was kind of hard for me to know for sure on my ovulation day. Not the biggest deal. And this, when you chart, it's also good to start early, because this isn't going to tell you when you start to ovulate. It's going to tell you after the fact. So you know when you had a rise in your temperature, that was when you ovulated, and you can pinpoint that. But going back and looking at it is going to tell you how long your cycle is. And then once you've done that for a couple months, you can actually predict when you're going to ovulate, so you can time it better. With this, there are other factors you can check that kind of relate to the fertility. Your cervical mucus actually changes throughout your cycle as well. That's just the discharge. You can look at it in your underwear. And it does vary from person to person, but typically the consistency will change throughout your cycle. And that'll actually also, in relation with your temperature, will kind of help you figure out when you ovulate. I'm not going to go into detail on that because there's a lot into it, but it's really not that hard to go through and start all this. And it is a huge help to know your timing, because if you're just guessing, it's going to take you a lot longer. You have no idea if you're hitting the right time points or not. So charting is a really good place to start. It's not as hard as you think. It's not as complicated as you think. A great tool that I use was fertilityfriend.com. I will post a link to it in the description. But it's free to use, free to sign up. You can get a premium membership, but it's not really necessary. It'll also start you off with a free trial of that. But it's a really good tool to track all these. It'll also give you a whole intro course that you can take into learning how to do it. And you can do a different one every day. You can read it all at once. I just got them sent as emails. Honestly, I didn't even read all of them, even though I would recommend reading them because they're helpful information. But the tracking really wasn't as difficult as I thought it would be. So I highly suggest starting to do it. It's a really good tool to take advantage of. And with that, you can also buy ovulation predictor kits. Now, these will vary from price. You can buy a cheaper brand like Wanfo's. You can find them on Amazon.com. You can buy Clear Blue brand, which is the more high-end brand, very accurate. It's really clear to read. Their digital ones give you a little smiley face on the day you ovulate. So you know that is the day that you should have sex. That's the day you're ovulating. Go have some good time with your significant other. But they are a little bit pricier. Wanfo's is just a little strip that you either pee on or dip in a pee in a cup. Again, that's the only way to test for these things, but it's not as hard as you think. You can buy those for a whole bunch for very cheap, so it's a good way to go to get started to kind of look at that. And that'll just tell you when you're actually ovulating throughout the month as well. So using an ovulation predictor kit in combination with charting your temperature is a great way to go as well. You're going to get a really accurate view of what your cycle is, typically. And again, like I said, cycles can vary a little bit. So I had some variation in my cycles that I wasn't expecting. I was like, oh, I should be getting my period soon. And it didn't. Or I got it a couple days early, which was surprising. Which can also be a little confusing too, because you can have implantation bleeding when you are pregnant. This is actually fairly rare. It only occurs in, I think, about a third of women, and I could be wrong on that statistic, so don't quote me on it. But a lot of people, when they're trying to conceive, I saw a lot of posts about, oh, I had just a little bit of spotting or a little bit of blood. I wonder if this is implantation bleeding. Implantation bleeding doesn't happen to that very many people. A lot of times it's just spotting, so I wouldn't count on it if it's a little early. And this will happen a little bit before your expected period date. So it happens when the blastocyst actually implants into your uterus. So don't automatically jump to that conclusion. I know for myself, I actually experienced spotting typically before I actually got my period, and just for a couple days beforehand. And And this was something I didn't even really notice or think about that much until I was trying to conceive actively. And then when I actually did get my positive, I didn't have spotting a couple days before I was expecting it. But I didn't quite have a positive on my pregnancy test yet. So that was an indicator for me. But again, like I said, you're regular until you're not. So just because I didn't spot that month didn't really necessarily mean, hey, I'm pregnant. But that was the case for me, so. Another thing I wanted to mention is, I didn't know this, but lube is not good for sperm. So if you typically use a lube-like product during your bedroom time, you want to avoid this for while you're trying to conceive. It can actually kill sperm. It's not good or conducive to trying to conceive. Even spit is not the best for sperm. So if you follow any of that, you want to either stop it completely, or you can buy Sperm Safe Lube. Preseed is a brand that I know of, and it's for trying to conceive. It's supposed to not kill the sperm. So that's something, if you need it, consider getting Preseed. And if you use the lube, you know it's not going to mean you can't get pregnant. But it's something to keep in mind, something that I didn't know ahead of time. So Preseed can be pretty easily found at any drugstore. So that is another thing to keep in mind. When you do actually finally get your positive test, which hopefully is soon, keep in mind that your doctor might not see you right away. You know, it's not one of those things where you're like, oh, I'm pregnant, and they're like, okay, come on in. They might not want to wait till 12 weeks to see you. They really trust those pregnancy tests. So if you get your positive, don't be surprised if you're not rushing into the doctor the next day. They might wait till 12 weeks. I ended up going in at 8 weeks myself, but that was only because I had some spotting issues early in pregnancy. I'm not going to go into that here. I will at some point post another video about things I wish I knew about being pregnant, so I'll kind of talk about that there, but something to keep in mind for when the time comes for you. And the last, not necessarily something I wish I knew, but piece of advice I have for you if you're trying to conceive actively is get involved in a forum. There are so many out there, and for me, I know I found it really helpful to be able to go on, see what other women were going through. It's how I learned about a lot of different things. It's very informative and educational, and it gives you a good support base as well. You don't even have to post on there frequently if you don't like doing that. You can just go on and read what other people have posted, and you're going to learn a ton. I used the Bump as a forum simply because I used their sister site, The Knot, when I was planning my wedding, so it kind of worked out. I segued into that. But I know a lot of people on there didn't like it because the girls that were on the board at the time were very down-to-earth, very honest, and kind of got sick of hearing the same questions over and over again. So they could be a little snarky, so to say, with them. The regulars on there posted and replied a lot, which again, you don't necessarily have to be, but there's so many different ones out there that you can find one that you fit into and are happy with. And it's just a great tool to be able to talk to other people going through the same things you're going through. Especially if you were like me and didn't really want to tell people that you were trying to conceive at the time, a forum was a great way for me to learn about it, talk to other people about it, without necessarily telling everybody I knew, hey, I'm trying to have a baby. Because I really wasn't ready for that at the time. So that's everything I have for tips on trying to conceive. As I said, I'll eventually be following this up with a video on things I wish I knew about being pregnant, but that'll probably be a little ways down the road. Next, I'll probably just do another weekly update on my pregnancy, and eventually I'm going to be talking about making a daddy survival kit, because I made one for my husband for Valentine's Day, and I really liked it, so I'm kind of excited to share with everybody what I did, where I got the ideas, and what I put into mine. So thanks for watching for this video. Feel free to send a comment or like the post, and let me know if you have any suggestions. If anyone else has any other tips for those out there trying to conceive that they want to add to the comments, please feel free. It would be thanks for watching. See you next time.